Hello everyone, it's my pleasure to welcome you all. Today I am going to discuss about one of the Shakespearean women characters in this presentation. Let's get into the topic. Before moving to the topic, let's get a clear view on women in Shakespeare's period and Shakespearean women characters. I have a question that, what would Macbeth be without Lady Macbeth or Romeo and Juliet with only Romeo? Yet there is an enormous disparity between female and male representation in Shakespeare's play. Of the total 981 characters, 826 are men while only 155 are women. Even some women roles are played by men, then women were given less importance. But Shakespeare comedies often features on women than Shakespeare's tragedy. Women in Shakespeare's plays are often underestimated, and he also portrays women in power are treated with distrust. For example, Lady Macbeth from Macbeth and Cleopatra from Antonio and Cleopatra. Shakespeare's presentation of women in his plays demonstrates his feelings about women and their roles in society. One of the examples is Juliet. According to their characterization, Shakespearean women were categorized into six types. Looking at the types of female roles, Shakespeare demonstrates that women had less freedom than their male counterparts in Shakespeare's time. All female characters in his plays should depend on male. If they are not, then they are not considered as an ideal woman. However, shrewd young women appear frequently in Shakespeare's play. As I already said above, in this presentation, I am going to discuss about a female character from the type the witty but unmarriable. We can take Catherine from The Taming of the Shrew as a prime example. Feminists have commented that the enjoyment of this play is marred by the fact that a man literally breaks Catherine's spirit when Petruchio says, "Come on and kiss me, Kate." Should we really celebrate this as a happy ending? Similarly, in the plot to Much Ado About Nothing, Benedick ultimately conquers the feisty Beatrice by saying, "Peace, I will stop your mouth." These women are presented as clever, bold and independent, but are put in their place by the end of the play. Let us discuss about Catherine Minola for the example, the witty but unmarriable. If you want to say in a single line, then The Taming of the Shrew is how Petruchio tames the shrewd woman Catherine to be ideal woman. This is what the plot moves on. Widely reputed throughout Padua to be a shrew, Catherine is foul-tempered and sharp-tongued at the start of the play. She constantly insults and degrades the men around her, and she is prone to wild displays of anger during which she may physically attack whomever enrages her. Though most of the play's characters simply believe Catherine to be inherently ill-tempered, she may act like a shrew because she is miserable and desperate. In short, Catherine feels out of a place in our society due to her intelligence and independence. She is unwilling to play the role of the maiden daughter and not to marry any man. Next, in the upcoming slides, we can see her complete transformation from Act 1 to Act 4. Much of what we know about Kate initially comes from what other people say about her. In Act 1, for instance, we see her only briefly and hear her speak even less. Yet our view of Catherine is fairly well established. Shakespeare, though, is setting up a clever teaching lesson, helping us later to see the errors of our own hasty judgment. Right after Baptista announces that Kate must marry before Bianca may take suitors, Romeo colors our interpretations of the elder daughter by declaring she's too rough for me. Later in the scene, Romeo reiterates his dislike for Kate, demeaning her as a fiend of hell. and offering that though her father be very rich and man is so very a fool to be married to her. Finishes off with the declaration that to marry Kate is worse than to take her dowry with this condition to be whipped at the High Cross every morning. Hortensio too is quick to add to the foray, calling Kate a devil and claiming that she is not likely to get a husband unless she is of gentler, milder mold. Tranio, Luciano's servant, is perhaps the only man in the scene not to disparage Kate, diagnosing her as a stark, mad or wonderful forward. Though other characters encourage us to see her as unmannerly, deserving of marginalization and abuse, but her demand is fairly reasonable. For instance, the first lines we hear her speak are to her father, imploring him not to wed her to a fool. Although it seems so rude, one must open up for their needs rather than being shut. There are many possible sources for Catherine's unhappiness. She expresses jealousy about her father's treatment of her sister, but her anxiety may also stem from feelings about her own undesirability. The fear that she may never win a husband, her loathing of the way men treat her, and so on. In Act 2, we get another look at Catherine and learn a bit more about what motivates her seemingly outrageous behavior. As Act 2 opens, Kate enters dragging Bianca with her hands tied. On one level, the mere act of one sister roping the other and handling her roughly for a perceived injustice is comic. But when we stop and consider from Kat's perspective, we can have a bit more empathy. Venting her anger that Bianca should be indulged with the sweetest while she remains alone. It seems to us to be a fairly reasonable demand rather than shrewish once again. Granted, she is an intelligent and spirited woman who wouldn't be satisfied with the simpering men such as Grimio and Hortensio. Rather, she needs a strong man to complement her own strong and powerful personality. When Baptista enters and comes to Bianca's rescue, we learn what's really underlying Kate's behavior. She is angry at the way Baptista favors her younger sister. Although Catherine in the early acts of the play seems reasonably well motivated in her actions, the manner in which she carries out her feelings is perhaps what most marks her as a shrew. Her actions are decidedly unladylike, revealing Kate's inability to deal in an adult manner with what she is feeling. In short, she comes across as a child who has learned that the best way to get what she wants is to cajole, bully and lash out, whereas later she will reason and be able to contain her behavior. From early on, we see Kat as a scrapper ready to enter into a physical brawl rather than risk not getting her way. This is what makes her to get rid of those social roles. By the time the play hits its midpoint, however, Kate begins her transformation, moving from egocentric misery to a decidedly more mature. In this case, she thought happiness is found through marriage. My tongue will tell me the anger of my heart, or else my heart concealing it will break. This quote is delivered by Catherine to Hortensio in the Act 4. Which means she expresses whatever she wants to say, she will speak as freely as she like rather than hiding it. This one shows her no fear. Despite the humiliations and deprivations that Petruchio adds to her life, it is easy to understand why Catherine might give away to marry a man like him. In their first conversation itself, Petruchio establishes that he is Catherine's intellectual and verbal equal, making him on some level an exacting change from the easily dominated man who normally surrounds her. Literally, we can notice her change after the wedding. At every possible situation, she has the reason to fight. Instead, she defends herself and shows kindness. Petruchio's forcible treatment of Catherine is in every way designed to show her that she has no real choice but to adapt to her social role as a wife. This adaptation must be attractive to Catherine on some level, since even if she dislikes the role of wife, playing it at least means she can command respect and consideration from others rather than suffer the universal revulsion she receives as a shrew. Having a social role, even if it is not ideal, must be less painful than continually rejecting any social role at all. Thus, Catherine's eventual compliance with Petruchio's self-serving training appears more rational than it might have seemed at first. By the end of the play, she has gained a position and even an authoritative voice that she previously had been denied. She clearly abhors the society's expectations that she obey her father and show grace and courtesy towards her suitors. At the same time, however, Catherine must see that, given the rigidity of her social situation, her only hope to find a secure and happy place in the world lies in finding her husband. These inherently conflicting impulses may lead to her misery and poor temper. A vicious circle ensues. The angrier she becomes, the less likely it seems she will be able to adapt to her prescribed social role. The more alienated she becomes socially, the more her anger grows. Kate has come to a level of maturity, able to handle things in an adult manner. Her speech at the end of the play does not reflect a tamed shrew, but rather a richer, more developed woman than the one seen at the story's beginning. Thanks for being. I hope you all liked my presentation. Thanks a lot.